So we were discussing the fourth sutra of Samadhipada. In your printed book, the first chapter, the sutra, as I mentioned, discussed last class, Vrittisarupyam Itaratra. So there are two words, Vrittisarupyam and Itaratra. These are two words. The first word to be discussed is Itaratra. The simple translation will be something like this. At other times, the identification of the seer with the vritti takes place. So, at other times, in other situations, other circumstances. So, here is a reference to the previous sutra. So, you can see the previous sutra. Tada drashtu surupi avasthanam. That is a previous sutra. The previous statement, aphorism statement, says, then the abundance of the seer in its own true nature, the subject manifests in his true nature. What's the true nature? For that you have to refer to its previous sutra, which is the second sutra of the Samadhipada, which is supposed to be the most important sutra in the entire text of Patanjali. So total there are 195 aphorisms, small pithy statements, sutras, be divided into four chapters. Of this second sutra of Samadhipada, Yogaha Chittavritti Nirodhaha, is a definition of yoga. Very brief definition. So what is yoga? Yoga is nothing but the cessation of vrittis. Vrittis means modifications. Our identification with whatever we do. Whatever we experience with eyes, with the sense of eyes, sense of hearing, sense of touch, sense of smell, any of the five senses of perception, we immediately identify with that. That's what really happens when we do not practice yoga. So when there is an unhappy experience, immediately we identify ourselves as the one who is suffering. So we forget our true nature. We interpret ourselves, we begin to understand ourselves as an ordinary psychophysical mechanism that is displeased with something, so gets angry or maybe unhappy or grief-stricken. So any ordinary stimuli from external world or from our own internal experiences will upset the mind, because we identify ourselves with every single fluctuating experience. This is our very, this is in fact, this is a total negation of our true identity. We are by our true nature the Purusha, the Atman, the omnipresent, the immanent divine reality. That is completely forgotten, and instead, when we face a physical problem, we immediately identify ourselves with the physical experience. So I can give a simple example. This is very, very simple, nothing philosophical. See, if we identify ourselves with this physical body, so there are people who may not have much of an education, maybe they are living at a physical level, not very different from the level of the animal kingdom. They want food, animals want food. They want shelter, so too animals. So at that level, any physical problem, physical unpleasantness will have a devastating effect on our personality. Because we are living at a physical level, we interpret ourselves as a physical being, which is in reality the grossest and the lowest denomination of our true identity. Then suppose you become an intellectual, you become a philosopher, you become a scientist, and you are engaged in research activities, or you are a musician or an artist who you are trying to perfect your skill in an art or music or as a scientist in your scientific experiments. At that time, a small physical problem won't upset you, because you have elevated yourself from your grossest physical dimension. You may call it an intellectual dimension, which in the your tantra tradition called Ajna Chakra, means the higher intellectual level. So a great scientist who has dedicated his life for scientific experiments, scientists who are also seekers of truth. So this is not very easy, of course, you know. If you are a scientist, and also if you are in quest for a truth, for unrevealing the mystery of universe, that means science also becomes a kind of philosophical quest. Or if you are a musician of a higher type, Mozart, Beethoven, or a scientist like Einstein, or a great artist, if when you reach that level of your evolution, it's not necessarily spiritual evolution, even intellectual ordinary evolution, then a small physical problem won't upset you. You can hear Stephen Hawking, and physically in a very, very undesirable condition. You know, we need not explain. But for him, you know, it's not a big problem, because he has elevated himself to a higher level. I don't call it, may not be a spiritual level, you may call it a scientist. That means you have lifted yourself above the physical, the grossest physical level. Then the physical problems won't have a devastating effect on you. That's why if we can think of a higher ideal in our life, smaller problems at the physical level, poverty or minor diseases, won't have a devastating impact on your life. And if you can elevate yourself to higher spiritual level, going beyond the philosophical level, beyond the level of higher intellectual activities like music, art, or science, scientific research, then even at the intellectual level, even intellectual problems won't have a devastating effect on you. Because then you interpret yourself as something that goes far beyond the physical, beyond the emotional, beyond even the intellectual. You elevate yourself to a spiritual dimension. And when you reach that dimension, no problem at a physical level, empirical level, will have a devastating effect on you. So, in fact, yoga here means going or reaching this higher spiritual dimension, where the vrittis, I already explained what vrittis are. Today the discussion will continue in the coming sutras. So it may, because the Yoga Sutra text goes on expanding the implication given in this particular sutra, Yogaha Chitta Vritti Nirodhaha. This is the essence of the entire yoga text. All the 195 sutras are condensed in this particular sutra, the second sutra. Chitta Vritti Nirodha means elevating ourselves to the higher yoga level by transcending the pull of vrittis, vasanas, samskaras, impressions, and memories at the physical and intellectual level, reaching the spiritual level. That's the meaning. Cessation of these vrittis, that is yoga. Already we have described what chitta is. So from now onwards, each sutra is related to the previous sutra and also the succeeding sutra. So that is the second sutra. So in the third sutra, it is said then, tada means then, when you reach this yoga level, then what happens? Drashtu Surubhi Avasthanam. Drashta means Purusha, means when we elevate ourselves beyond the physical, beyond the emotional, beyond the intellectual level, then what happens? We get established in our true nature. And our true nature is that we are the Atman, the omniscient, the all-pervading, the immanent spiritual reality that is not at all affected by anything that happens at the physical, mental, or intellectual level. That's why the commentators made a statement, when do you turn to yoga? The first sutra, Atha Yoga Anushasana. Now, from now onwards, we start a discussion on yoga. When do we turn to yoga? Yoga should always be understood at the higher spiritual life, connecting or linking ourselves to a higher spiritual ideal. So, Atha means then, when? When we find a great need to look, to find an answer to some of the questions that naturally come to us, that naturally will come to a person when he or she is able to think beyond today's problems, beyond the everyday problems, beyond the empirical problems at the physical level, at the worldly level, when we begin our search for an answer, for higher questions of life and existence, then we turn to yoga. That is the meaning of Atha. At a very, very ordinary level, I can say, well, suppose you lose all your money in an ordinary context, when we turn to higher spiritual life. There are many, many ways. When we are faced with a problem, problems can be of many, many types. It could be a personal tragedy, or it could be a disappointment. You work hard for something, do your best, but you don't get the expected result. You help somebody with all anticipation of a reciprocal attitude or gratitude, you get the opposite result. Then also you suddenly are confronting a dilemma. And that dilemma is the opposite of ordinary logic of life. Because in ordinary mathematics and science, 2 plus 2 is 4. It cannot be anything else. But in our real life, 2 plus 2 is 4 logic may not apply. That logic doesn't apply. If it applied, then we all be machines, really speaking. Unless there are some unknown, imponderable, inexplicable mysteries in life, we will never go beyond the physical level. You know, animals don't become philosophers. Because at the instinct level, 2 plus 2, your logic alone works for them. In human life, when we find that there are certain things that are beyond our control, certain phenomena that is beyond logical explanation, then we look for an explanation. We realize the fact the explanation is not available at the worldly level, empirical level. Then we turn to yoga, higher wisdom, higher philosophy. It could be a man like Buddha, a great prince who was born as a prince, lived in luxurious circumstances, but suddenly he was confronted with the questions of sickness, old age, and death. He wanted to find an answer to this mystery. He turned to yoga. So all these are different ways of turning towards yoga. But Patanjali makes a point, this is only turning towards yoga. Maybe you are being compelled to turn to yoga, but once you start your journey, you don't just stop with moving away from some undesirable, unpleasant things. You start moving towards something higher. That is the second step in yoga. First step in yoga is leaving these empirical, ordinary, physical things behind. Second step is moving towards something higher. And moving towards something higher requires some samskaras, impressions, vrittis, a deliberate effort to go beyond the ordinary circumstances and the pulls of compulsions and circumstances. And that method is called cessation of vrittis, going beyond the influence of vrittis, as I already mentioned here. So when we transcend those vrittis, we get established now true nature or spiritual dimension. That is this third sutra. We are still discussing the fourth sutra, vritti sarupam idratra. If we don't turn to yoga, what happens? We identify ourselves with every vritti. So vritti, I have already explained earlier, what is vritti? So I'll try to repeat once more. So vrittis here means a residual element of whatever we experience, do or undergo. A word, a deed, an action or a thought, a flash of thought or idea also can create a residual element in the mental system, which is called chittam. What we do or anything that we experience, we undergo, a verbal action, we're speaking a word, and physical action, an activity or a thought or an idea, it may have one visible, immediate, tangible effect, but it also will have another invisible, more lasting effect. It produces a samskara. It produces a tendency in our mental system. So, and that tendency can take different forms. That's why, as I mentioned in the last class, we feel ourselves helpless. We want to do certain things, but when we really try, we don't always succeed. There is always a conflict between what we want to do deliberately in all earnestness and what our mind permits us to do, what our personality permits us to do. Always a conflict. And this conflict is one important sign of certain tendencies, impressions that are already accumulated in our mental system, which constitute our true character. So the fourth sutra, the translation is, at other times, if we don't turn to yoga, what happens? We go on identifying ourselves with every momentary impulses, circumstances of vrittis. When there is an unpleasant event, we lose our balance. The unpleasant event can be an unpleasant experience at the physical level. If we interpret ourselves as a physical being, then a physical problem will be a big dilemma, a devastating problem. When we become intellectually evolved, then physical problems take a back seat. But even intellectual level is not the highest. Going beyond the intellectual, at the spiritual level, if you reach that level, then all empirical problems, the physical and intellectual and emotional, belonging to worldly life, will become totally irrelevant. It's not that there will be no problems. There will be problems, but we will understand, we will get an insight into the nature of problems. And once we get a higher intuitive insight into the nature of problems, what happened? The problems appear to be lesser problems. It's not that problems will not exist. Questions are not answered. Questions just cease to exist. Problems cease to be problems. Not that they vanish. They appear to be lesser problems. That's what really happens. So here, at other times, what are the times that this happens when we identify ourselves with all these external impulses and problems, when we don't turn to yoga, what are those circumstances? That is implied by this word itaratra, means at other times. Means at times other than when we practice yoga. So, as I mentioned, you know, the commentators, we are dealing with the commentators. So, The most important commentary on Patanjali Yoga Sutra, as I mentioned, is Vyasa's commentary. So we are, according to those great older commentators, it is called these other times, means at on occasions other than when we are in a state of Asamprajnata Samadhi, which is the highest state. But let us see, when we turn to yoga, we may not reach the Asamprajnata Yoga or Asamprajnata Samadhi. You find when you turn to spiritual life, you find your priority changes. If we can just revise our priority, many of the problems in life will cease to be. Because when you turn to spiritual life, the first thing that happens is there is a reversal of priorities. I mentioned this in the last class. When we turn to higher life, when we turn to yoga, what happens, you know, another parallel life begins to evolve. Suddenly, our life takes a new direction. On the one hand, our ordinary life and all those circumstances continue as they are. On the other hand, we also become slowly aware of the fact that it is possible to live a higher life, higher than what we are leading now. It is possible to prioritize or to set a new set of priorities, so that, as I mentioned, earlier problems will cease to be problems. This meaning of Asamprajnata Samadhi. So one of the commentators was, he was a king, he was King Bhoja. He wrote a commentary, it's called Rajamartanda. So he says, yogat anyasmin kali, on occasions other than when we turn to yoga. What happens? Every moment we identify ourselves with events. When you have an unpleasant interaction with people, say quarrel, or difference of opinion in your office or a factory or anywhere in workplace, that experience will always it will be haunting the mind. It again comes to the surface. Or if somebody you lose a bank balance has come down, or profits level go down, or any I'm talking about ordinary life situations. Spiritual life is still higher. So on all these occasions, what happened, you know, all these problems will have a haunting effect, a devastating effect on the mental system. That's because we are living at that level. So one method is to change to yoga. So that's Bhoja says, yogat anyasmin kale. On any occasion, circumstances in life, when we are not practicing yoga, what happens? Every moment we identify ourselves as the one who has lost his money. So Shankaracharya in commentary in the Chandogya Upanishad, the sixth chapter, there's long passages in Shankaracharya's commentary. So some of these statements are like, Ham Dukhi, you see, I am now grief-stricken. I am one who has lost my home. I am one who has become poor. Or I am the one who has become rich. I am the one who has quarreled with somebody. So only the I, by I, we mean the ordinary physical, psychophysical mechanism. It is an example of itaratra, means on occasions other than when you are practicing yoga. That's the, in a non-yoga context, so to speak. So that is why this commentator Bhoja says, Yadrishyo vrittayo dukkhamoka sukhadhyatmika pradurbhavandi tadruk rupa eva samvedide vyavahartrubhi purushaka. Means, on all such occasions, what happens, you know, these vrittis, which are produced by circumstances and interactions, which may produce sukha, dukkha, moha, etc., means pain, pleasure, desire, anger, and so many, all these emotions. These emotions, they evolve, they emerge in various circumstances in our life. And every moment when such emotions emerge, we identify ourselves with those emotions. So what happens? We forget our true nature, that we are the Atman. So that is the meaning of itaratra, means on occasions other than when we are turning to yoga. So that's the idea behind. Of course, again, tadevam yasmin egagradaya parinade chita chidishaktehi susmin surube pradishthanam bhavati. So the whole point is, when the mind is not fully turned to a higher spiritual ideal, every moment becomes an occasion for us to identify ourselves with all the insignificant, ordinary things in this world. One may ask the question, are they really insignificant? You may ask the question, money is lost, job is gone, job security is a problem. Is it insignificant? When are we able to look upon these worldly problems as something insignificant? For that, we have to turn to Vedanta. Yoga culminates in Vedanta. So Vedanta tells you that this empirical world, with all experiences, pain and pleasure, success and failure, good and bad, they are there, but they are not everlasting. All these are relative, ever-changing, impermanent phenomena. Momentariness, what is called momentariness, called Kshanigata in Buddhist tradition. So once we understand this, then we don't run away from the world. You don't stop seeking for a job. You don't stop working for your livelihood. The point is, we are able to work for our livelihood. We are able to confront the realities and problems of everyday life with a higher wisdom, with a higher intelligence. The only advantage is we can do that without so much of anxiety and problem and worries. That's all. That's the only point. That's the only advantage. Not that we should stop working. We will continue working. The point is, we'll be working from a higher perspective. So that is the meaning of yoga here. Now, this identification with various everyday events, of course, according to the commentators, they are of two types, which for future, contemplation, I can present before you. It's called Vrittisarupyata, means the identification with everyday experiences. One is subjective, that means we identify ourselves as the physical body or the psychophysical mechanism. I am, it is called Asmita, which means it is subjective. How we interpret ourselves? What is our true nature? What is my true nature? Who am I? What am I? If I am an ordinary physical being, then a small illness or disease means it will be a crushing blow. If I'm an intellectual evolved person, a musician or a scientist or a philosopher, then problems at the physical level may not be much of a problem. There will be lesser problems. If I lose my research thesis which I'm working on, somebody has stolen, it will be a bigger problem than the problem that I may feel suddenly the doctor says I have an illness, some kind of a illness, heart attack or something. It may not have a devastating problem. The problem would be much more if you suddenly find that your research thesis you're working on is stolen once for all, gone once for all. It's a devastating blow. You don't worry much about the physical health or anything. So at the higher level. So at the lowest level, we identify ourselves the physical body. The second kind of vrittisarupya identification is samyoga, which is objective, where you identify yourself with various external things. I know this, I want that, I don't want that. You are mind going after various objects external in the external world. That is one kind of identification. It's called samyoga in the yoga terminology. The other one is Asmita. Asmita is means something. Asmi in Sanskrit, aham asmi, I am, means who am I? How do I interpret myself? What am I in my own opinion, so to speak? If we can have a higher opinion about our own real stuff, so to speak, our personality, then also the problem can be solved. So the commentators divide this identification into two categories. One is Asmita, with regard to, who am I? Identification with our own buddhi vritti. Who am I in my own opinion? Who am I? How do I interpret myself? The other identification is when we connect the external objects. I want this, I don't want this, I know that, I don't know this, all this. These are two types of identifications. Now, how do they really work? So, for that, we have to turn to another sutra, which is, of course, you need not worry about it, but the sutra, those who are interested, those who are listening to this class on later on, can refer to the third sutra of Sadhanapada, which clearly explains what this Asmita is. Avidya Asmita Raga Dvesha Abhinivesha Kleshaha. So Kleshas are explained here. Of this Asmita, or means our own ego consciousness as to what we identify ourselves with, is the basis of many of these wrong identifications. After that, the next sutra explains what are vrittis. It's a very important sutra because vrittis are very important. I already mentioned earlier vritti, karma, vritti, samskara, chakram. It is a wheel which constitutes our personality, which we inherit when we are born again. Whatever we do, whatever actions we do, whatever word we speak, will produce an invisible result, residual element, is called vritti. That vritti, when it becomes strong, will become a tendency. That tendency will become an action-oriented tendency called vasana. And all these will produce a samskara, a set of characteristics. So these vrittis and samskaras could be understood only against the background of two cardinal principles of yoga, Vedanta, and also other oriental traditions like Buddhism. One is the doctrine of karma, the law of karma, and the doctrine of reincarnation. One important doctrine is that whatever we do will produce a result. And that result has got two aspects. The visible result. You harm a person, or you help a person, which could be good and bad, whatever may be. The person whom you help receives your help. That's one visible, tangible result. Then your action of helping a person will cause a particular consequence to emerge, a result. It is called a vritti. So according to the ancient Indian philosophy of Mimamsa, it is called adrishta and apurva. It is called apurva because when you do something, an effect, a result is produced. It is not visible. It will remain there as a vritti, as a tendency, as a samskara in our mind. Either it could be at the subjective or level, objective level. Subjective level, if the effect or the result of our action is happy, a pleasant, happy one, then what happens? We will have a tendency to continue that action. If it is an unhappy one, we may avoid that action. And this is a mental level. Second, and is much more important, it produces a kind of deposit that is put in our account, which is called karma phala. So normally what we call karma in ordinary language, you know, conversation, this is what it really means. Karma means action, but what we mean by karma phala means the result of action. So these tendency, these actions, not necessarily physical actions, is a word that is spoken, a thought that is thought, an idea that is thought, that comes to the mind, all can produce an effect. And we will reap the harvest of what we sow in this life when we are born again. So these two aspects should be kept in mind when we understand the meaning of vrittis, this karma vritti chakra. Means it is a cycle. That means action, vritti, which produces memories, impressions, then samskaras, tendencies, then a tendency to continue the action, a deep-rooted tendency with which we are born again. So that's why we have a inherent tendency to do certain things or not to do certain things, and born again. So this cycle continues. So such vrittis are fivefold according to Patanjali Sutra here. Vrittaya panchataya means vrittis are fivefold. Klishtaha klishtaha means some of them are in with kleshas, some of them are without kleshas. There's a meaning of this. So we should understand what is klesha here. What are these vrittis and what are the kleshas? These five vrittis will be described in the next sutra. So you find pramana viparyaya vikalpa nidra smrutayaha that we referred to in the last class, but we didn't discuss that elaborately. So the first part of the sutra is vrittis are fivefold, which we are going to discuss in the sixth sutra. But then there is a rejoinder, klishtaha klishtaha. Klishta means vrittis which are endured with kleshas. Aklishta means vrittis which are not endured with kleshas. What are kleshas? A very interesting word in Patanjali system, klesha. So kleshas are explained here in another sutra. So which you can see in our previous classes, but we discussed this earlier as a preparatory class. So it's explained, a definition of klesha, you find the third sutra of Sadhanapada in your printed book, the second chapter, third sutra. Avidya asmita raga dvesha abhinivesha pancha kleshas. So all the vrittis that are produced by your actions belong to two categories. One, certain vrittis which may not bear fruit in this life but will bear fruit in the next life, because these vrittis, these samskaras, these tendencies are stored in a vessel which is called Karmashaya, which we discussed earlier. There are certain vrittis and tendencies which may influence our actions in this life itself. Now, if you want a proof, I can give the example, as I mentioned earlier. There are many people who get highly excited when they pray, when they meditate, or when they read great books or listen to great ideas. And they want to start a new life. Even criminals, there are many criminals who would like to start a new life, but cannot. Do not always succeed. So there is, on one hand, there is a real sincere will, desire to bring about a change in our life, to start a new course. But then there is always an invisible mental block. It's not always the creation of circumstances. Very often it may be something that is inherent in the person. A set of inherent tendencies, what we call samskaras or vrittis, which just do not permit you to do what you sincerely want to do. This may not apply in the context of ordinary physical actions. See, whether you want to turn to the left or right, if want to take, when you drive, whether you take one freeway or another freeway, is a physical action you can choose. But you cannot really have your own options as to what you want to think, what idea you want to follow. When you, at the level of thoughts and ideas, at the subtle level of mental activities, emotions, we have very little choice. Very often we are helpless. At the level of physical actions, we have plenty of freedom. So why this mental block? So Patanjali system tells us that it is due to certain tendencies, impressions, samskaras, which are stored in what is called Karmashaya. So what is Karmashaya? Karmashayas are certain tendencies which produce a kind of samskaras. In a way, they themselves are a set of samskaras. What you call karmic residue, it could be called. They are very subtle, which may not operate in the present life, but will have a strong effect. They may operate in the next life. Now the point is, it's not that we are victims or we are slaves of our karmasya. Patanjali doesn't mean that. Remember, it's very important. Sometimes this karma doctrine, in a grossly misinterpreted form, this karma doctrine is interpreted as a kind of fatalism or predeterminism. In fact, it is the very opposite of it. The doctrine of karma gives you plenty of freedom, plenty of opportunity to modify our life, to change our life, to change our character, to change our tendencies, and to change the way we think and act and speak and do things. So, why this is important? Because when we talk about these Klishta Vrittis, you know, Vrittis, tendencies or impressions, which are subtle in nature, which are stored in Karmashaya, which may not operate in this life, will continue to exist from life to life. So when we explain this, there is always a possibility of interpreting this as a kind of a doctrine of fatalism. In fact, it is the very opposite of it. Patanjali doesn't elaborate anything in this system. It's 195 small aphorisms, pithy statements. But what the commentators mean, the philosophy of Karmashaya, is very simple. Once we understand the nature of this Karmashaya, the nature of how we create vrittis, impressions and samskaras, and how they finally constitute our character, our tendencies and impressions, which are stored and which are again transferred from life to life throughout this life cycle, so to speak. Once we understand this, we will find out that it is really a doctrine of freedom. We can modify, we can bring about a change in these tendencies that we are creating. So that is what yoga is all about. So that should be understood very clearly. Now, coming to this subject again, avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha. I already mentioned this in the last class. These are the five kleshas. So one set of vrittis are related to these kleshas. Another set of vrittis are not related to these kleshas. So what are the kleshas? That should be explained. I already explained this, mentioned this. Whatever we do, whatever experiences we undergo, and our reaction to those experiences can be interpreted in a very scientific manner. So according to Patanjali's system, our experience is called
bhoga. It's called experience. Then our reactions to those experiences can be threefold. Strictly speaking, twofold, but in an expanded interpretation, threefold. So we can easily understand the dynamics of vrittis. First, experiences. Second, our reactions to those experiences. One set of reaction is a reaction that makes us move towards, if we have an experience which is happy and pleasant, then we may develop a liking for it. Though we do not want to like it, still we may develop a liking for it. It may not be always desirable. Still we develop a kind of obsessive bondage, a liking towards certain experiences. Then it's opposite. That means towards an experience. Then it's opposite is dvesha, means we may develop a strong dislike, aversion towards certain experiences. So strong dislike and strong liking. Strong liking, attachment, make us move towards that experience. A strong aversion could make us move against it. And sometimes if we are confronting fear, then it may make us move away from it. So it's called raga, dvesha, bhaya. Three words are used in the yoga terminology. Raga means excessive liking. Its opposite is dvesha. When we like certain things, we move towards it. When we dislike, we move against it. Then we move away from it. Now, these experiences will create a residual element in our system. So very often, if we can look for a minute, step aside, and observe ourselves, observe our own actions, in fact, our own thought processes, the way we talk. Sometimes there could be totally inexplicable liking certain things. We may be aware of it. That is absolutely meaningless, absolutely irrational. Still, we may have an attachment liking for certain things. And also, we may have a strong aversion, dislikes for certain things. That also could be totally irrational. So once we understand the dynamics of these vrittis, we can actually bring about a change in our own attitude. We can get rid of obsessive liking for certain things. We can get rid of obsessive aversion towards certain things. We can bring about a change in our own system. So that's one important advantage of Patanjali's system. The commentators make it a point. Patanjali doesn't ask you, interestingly, doesn't ask you to pray to a god. Patanjali he accepts God, but what he does is he's making a thoroughgoing psychological analysis into our own character, behavior, and personality. So we will have interaction now. Maybe we have got 5-6 minutes. So we'll continue the discussion in the next class.
My name is Fook. I have a question about the karma and the results of karma, and you know, how much of that is subjective versus objective, how you feel about what you're doing versus the actual outcome of the karma or the action itself.
The actual outcome of karma. So under normal circumstances.
Yeah, and how much is the karma a result of with the outcome, and then how you feel about the action itself.
Yeah, yes. So karma includes the outcome, the visible result that immediately follows, that we can all experience. And also an invisible consequence that we may not be aware of it at that time. It will be stored as a tendency in our mental system. And that tendency is called a vritti, becomes a samskara. It may not be easily obvious. It may not be visible at that time. So you can analyze a person's background, his actions on the basis of the samskaras, tendencies that he displays, because the inherent deep-rooted samskaras will always project and manifest in the way we speak, in the way we act, the way we react to circumstances. So both together are called karma phala. So the word karma in Sanskrit means action. But very often we use the word karma not to mean action but also its result. So somebody was mentioning in an ordinary conversation, you know, I got parking because of my karma, my good karma or bad karma. But actually, the karma here, a very, very gross example of how it is interpreted in a very superficial way. So karma means action, not necessarily physical action. When you have an idea flashing in your mind, a thought, or when you speak a word, or when you do certain things at the physical level, it all can be called karma. And it will produce one visible result. If you eat food or if you drink water, your thirst is quenched. If you travel, you reach your place. These are all visible, ordinary. We don't think much about it. But there is another kind of result. I can give an example. The food that we eat, or let us drink, it will satisfy our hunger and thirst. It is common. At a gross level, it's very, very common. But the food that we eat, according to yoga, has something else, something to do with the mind, the way we are going to think, the way we are going to interact and behave in our life. That is a subtle result of the quality of food. It has nothing to do with hygiene. It has something to do with the tendency with which the food is eaten, with which it is served, with which the tendencies and impressions and characteristics with which it is cooked, of the person who cooked. All these constitute a kind of invisible, which we can easily feel, but it's not visible. So here you find two consequences, visible and invisible. So also actions. Whatever actions we do will register a tendency, which may or may not be visible. Mostly it would be invisible. And also a visible consequence that is very obvious. Both together can be called the result of karma. And a subtle result is called vritti. The subtle invisible result, which may be in the form of a tendency, a characteristic, is called vritti. That's all we can say about vritti. Okay.
You use two words, vritti and samskara.
Yeah.
What is the difference between the two?
Yeah. Vritti, so for you, I explained already. When this vritti, when a number of identical similar actions are performed by us, they produce identical vrittis one after another, then they become a strong tendency to act and to behave according to these vrittis. And it is an essence, it becomes a tendency. It is called samskara. That samskara itself, when it becomes very strong, it becomes a vasana. To give an example, a child born in a family with an inherent tendency or interest in music, let us say, but if you study his geological tree, if it maybe his whole family tree, there was no musician, no connection with musical culture. But there are many examples like that. So how do you explain this inherent tendency without any explanation that we can make, either acquaintance with the musical, with the musicians when you were growing up, nothing of this kind. There are such tendencies. So yoga and Vedanta will tell you these tendencies have their source, their cause in some other life and experiences. It's a strong vasana. The word is vasana. So if he finds a musical instrument somewhere, he may have a tendency to go towards it. Of course, these are not common, but there are still the many examples, not just one. So certain such tendencies may be in music or philosophy or it could be. It is called vasana. It is much stronger than samskaras. Samskaras are stronger than vrittis. Vrittis are the subtle consequence of actions. Samskaras are subtle consequence of vrittis, and vasanas are still more subtle, very strong tendency which is subtler and stronger than samskaras. That's how it is.
I'm thinking that maybe what you're mainly referring to is individual karma, you're addressing each of us. But I wonder what you would say about collective karma, collective consequences of karma. I mean, just as a smaller example, that if you come in here and you have an off day compared to a day when you're on your game, then the consequences in terms of how we're affected by what you say could be different. And a larger scale example is if people are victims, or many people are victims of genocide, I don't think we're talking about individual consequences of karma, but there's some other more mass pervasive something happening there.
Well, how do you explain, for example, wars, genocides, massacres? How do you explain plagues and epidemics in which people die in large numbers, earthquakes and natural calamities, people die in large numbers? So could you explain this in the light of the doctrine of collective karma? Well, karmas are mostly analyzed at individual level. The collective karma ideal was first brought out by a historian. See, nations and societies, they go in a wave-like motion. So Arnold Toynbee, the famous British historian, according to him, there is always a forward movement for every civilization, every culture, every society. And then it's wave-like movement, then goes down. Then after some millennia, the same civilization goes up. So you find societies and nations and civilizations facing consequences of their evil actions one after another. Such ideas you find. But Patanjali's system doesn't address this question. Patanjali's system essentially addresses questions of individual spiritual life. It doesn't deal with this subject. If you extend this subject beyond Patanjali's system, we can say, nations and societies and families, institutions, if you analyze their progress, they could be, can explain this, they're facing the consequences of their actions, we can say. Sometimes you find ancient civilizations, you know. New civilizations emerge. See, for the last 500 years, America was unknown. So a new continent, you can see. Just after all, the oldest, compared to oldest civilizations in the world, which may be, say, 6,000 or 7,000 years old, is a new culture. So later, Greek or Roman, Assyrian, Babylonian, Egyptian, and then Greek or Roman, and then Mayan, Incan, and so on. And so you always find civilizations emerge, they vanish, and in their place, another civilization may re-emerge. Such things happen. So this is one way of extending doctrine of karma beyond the scope of Patanjali system, you can say. Toynbee has a lot to say about this. He says, for example, he sees a collective movement, a wave-like movement. So nations, civilizations, societies, cultures, they emerge, they reach the zenith of their glory and expansion, and then they fade away, and again new civilizations emerge. So this is one way of interpreting, but I don't think Patanjali would have, you won't be amused if you extend this doctrine to this level. That's all I can say. His main focus is the individual actions for concentration, purification of mind, spiritual uplifting of our life. That's what I mean. I'm talking within the scope of Patanjali system. It may be, it is true, you know, there is a, if you extend the logic to civilizations and nations, you can see this really happening. You can see. People say, for example, I'm not getting out of the context, but I can say, Roman Empire, look at Roman Empire. The last centuries of Roman Empire. Then Roman Senate, the Roman citizenry, they all practically reached a very low level of culture. What they did to Carthaginians after the Second Punic War, in Inter Carthage was destroyed, wiped out, what all heinous crimes they committed. So there are historians like Gibbon, you know, who wrote the Decline and Fall of Roman Empire. He would say that the Pompeii, the earthquake, Vesuvius, you know, it was it's a karmic reaction of nature towards what the Romans did in Carthage. Such statements you find. Of course, you should. I'm just giving the example from history. So also the Egyptian civilization, Indian civilization, Chinese, you know, all these ancient civilizations, they had their glorious times. So they went through this wave-like movement, reaching the zenith of their glory for some centuries and then fading away, again re-emerging. So perhaps this karmic doctrine can be extended beyond the scope of what Patanjali had in mind. That's true. I think there's a logic behind. This Toynbee, who is credited with this, because he was the one who elevated this level of philosophy. He made it a great speculative system. There's an inherent theme behind these historical phenomena. Going beyond the list of events, there is an inherent theme, a message behind the historical events. So if you go to that direction, you can find the echoes of this karmic theory in his interpretation of world civilizations. That is going beyond the scope of what Patanjali ever perhaps imagined or dreamt.
I'm not sure.
I can even extend one example. Of course, of course, I can give the example of Edgar Cayce, and Edgar Cayce is not always invoked with great respect or logic today, but one of his statements, he says, for example, Cortes and Pizarro, the Spanish conquistadors, you know, went to Latin America, you know, how the entire Mexican, Peruvian, all these civilizations were wiped out. So they were facing the consequences of practicing human sacrifice, which is part of the the Latin American, Central American cultures. So Mayan, Incan, they practiced. That's what he said. So you can find civilizations themselves and their fate and destinies can be interpreted as fulfillments of karmic doctrine extending. So beyond that, I don't know how to extend the karmic doctrine, the doctrine of karma, to collective life. That's all we can. Beyond that, I don't know how to logically extend it. So thank you. We had a wonderful discussion. I welcome discussion going beyond the Patanjali system. Okay. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.